Good morning, students. Welcome you all to my 10th video on the chapter alcohols, phenols and ethers, right? And of course it will be the last video of this particular chapter, right? In the previous video we discussed something about preparation of the ethers by using preparation of ethers starting from alcohols and by Williamson's ether synthesis. You know, we'll go for the properties of ethers, right? Physical properties and chemical properties. And to that, you know, we'll see first of all boiling points of ethers. And this is the first discussion under physical properties of ethers, that is boiling points. You know, as far as ethers are concerned, you know, the boiling points of ethers will be less than the corresponding alcohols with almost same molecular mass. Boiling point of ethers will be less than the corresponding alcohols with same molecular. You know, the boiling point of ethers will be less than corresponding alcohols. Boiling point of ethers will be less than the corresponding alcohols with same molecular mass. And of course, alcohols and ethers will form a functional isomerism. And because of that, you know, so here it is. If I say this is CH3CO CH3, one of the ethers, right? Its boiling point is less than that of corresponding alcohol with the same molecular mass, CH3CO. Dimethyl ether and this is ethanol. Its boiling point is less than that of ethanol because ethanol undergoes intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Ethanol undergoes intermolecular hydrogen bonding due to the presence of OH group, right? Diethyl ether or ethers, they do not undergo hydrogen bonding because they don't possess any OH group. Instead, ethers will be undergoing, you know, that is, in the case of ethers, you will find dipole-dipole attractions, and of course that too, weak dipole-dipole attractions. Because of that, you know, in the case of ethers, the extent of molecular association is less. In the case of ethers, extent of molecular association is less due to the presence of weak dipole-dipole attractions. Whereas in the case of high alcohols, due to the presence of this intermolecular hydrogen bonding, they undergo molecular association to the maximum extent and thereby boiling point increases. Apart from that, you know, I'll give one more example for the compound. Yes, this is ether. This is what we call it as anisole. Right? The boiling point of anisole is less than the corresponding alcohol with same molecular mass, that is benzyl alcohol. So that is what we call it as boiling point of alcohols and ethers. That is, the boiling point of ethers will be less than the corresponding alcohols because alcohols undergo intermolecular hydrogen bonding, ethers do not undergo intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Yes, so this is what we call it as the boiling point of ethers. Apart from that, you know, the textbook, you know, we need to study what we call it as solubility of ethers in acetic water. And as far as solubility is concerned, I said the higher members of all kinds of organic compounds will be insoluble in water. The difference lies in the case of lower members of acetic organic compounds. And as far as lower members of ethers are concerned, ethers are soluble in water. Lower members of acetic ethers. Yes, it is will be soluble in water because, you know, as far as ether is concerned, look at this. Here we have ether with two lone pairs on the oxygen, right? Ethers, you know, they can form hydrogen bond with acetic water molecules like this, with delta minus of oxygen will be attracting delta plus of hydrogen in the water molecule. And they have that ability of forming hydrogen bonding with water because they are characterized by oxygen atom. And that can also form one more hydrogen bonding with water. Yes, that is what we call it. Because of that, you know, because of that ability of ethers to form hydrogen bonds with water, lower members of ethers will be soluble in water. Or you can say that lower members of ethers will be miscible with water. And that is solubility of ethers. Now, with that information, I'll come to the very important discussion as far as your board exams and competitive exams are concerned, that is what we call it as chemical properties of ethers. Properties due to the cleavage of CO bond in ethers, right? And to that, you know, we have a discussion of action of HX. And of course, X can be I or it can be Br or it can be Cl. HX, it can be I or it can be Cl or it can be Br, right? And of course, I discussed this particular reaction under two headlines. that is reaction with symmetrical ethers. Symmetrical ethers are those ethers in which the alkyl groups attached to the oxygen atom will be same. Both the alkyl groups are same, and that is what we call it as symmetrical ether. When it comes in contact with HX, right? Look at this. And of course, that results in the formation of, yes it is, RX plus ROH. And this is haloalkane. And this is alcohol. This is symmetrical ether. Look at here, X is connected to R. X can be connected to this R, or it can be connected to this R, and you are going to get same product, no problem. Because in both, on either side, you are going to get same R. The alkyl group is same, and of course, no problem, you are going to get RX. You can connect X to this R group, or you can connect this to R group, okay now? You are going to get same product, yes? And if I use excess HX, this alcohol formed reacts further with HX, that is, if I use excess HX, and that results in the formation of OH is replaced by X, and you are going to get H2O. This is what we call it as haloalkane. Finally, you are going to get haloalkane, yes? For example, if I take this OCH3, one of the symmetrical ethers, that is methoxymethane. This is methoxymethane. When it reacts with hydrogen iodide, iodide will be connected to this CH3, or it can be connected to this CH3. Okay, now you are going to get same product, no problem here. And it is CH3I, and of course CH3OH, and this is iodomethane. If excess HI is used, CH3OH reacts with HI, and you are going to get CH3I, and of course H2O. This OH is replaced by I minus, and of course you are going to get iodomethane. This is what we call it as action of HX, and of course towards symmetrical ethers. As far as this reaction is concerned, HI is more reactive than HBr. HBr is more reactive than HCl. Reactivity order of hydrogen halides towards this particular reaction, towards the cleavage of CO bond in the case of ethers. As usual, HI is more reactive than HBr, because that is HI bond strength is weaker than HBr bond strength, and that is weaker than HCl bond strength. And then HI bond is weaker than HBr bond. HBr bond is weaker than HCl bond. As the strength of the bond decreases, reactivity increases. This is weakest bond that can be easily broken. Therefore, HI is very, very reactive. Why that bond strength is very, very less in the case of HI and the Prashna Madhara? Look at this. This is H attached to bulky I minus. This is H attached to Br. Yes. This is H attached to Cl. Observe this. If I move from iodine to chlorine, the size of the atom decreases. And therefore, here the hydrogen is holding very big atom, iodine, and therefore bond becomes very, very weak. It cannot hold that very big atom, is it not? But this can hold this small atom HCl. Therefore, this bond is very, very strong. This bond is very, very weak. Okay, na? As the size of the atom attached to the another atom increases, bond strength decreases, and of course reactivity increases. Therefore, HI is more reactive than HBr. HBr is more reactive than. Why that is so? Because HI is, bond strength of HI is weaker than bond strength of HBr. HBr bond strength is less than that of HCl because of this size difference. So this is what we call it as reactivity order of HX. And of course here it is, reaction of HX with symmetrical ethers. How the? Now, I will go for the reaction of HX with unsymmetrical ethers. That is, action of, yes it is, HX on unsymmetrical ethers. Unsymmetrical ethers. Unsymmetrical ethers. Okay, no? And of course, yes, it is. I'll go for it. Or O R dash. This is unsymmetrical ethers. This is unsymmetrical ether. Yes. Plus HX. Okay, no? Yes. Plus HX. Okay, no? Look at this, sir. Now, two possibilities. One possibility is this. If X minus is attached to R, you are going to get Rx. Remaining, yes, it is X plus will be connected to O, and of course it will be R dash OH. This is one possibility. Here, X minus is attached to R. Second possibility is, if X is attached to, X minus is attached to R dash. If X is at X minus is attached to R dash, you are going to get R dash X plus R OH. Is it not? Now then, so which is possible then? Which is correct? Is it, this is a product and this will be the product? Which will be possible? How then? And that is a question. That question rises only in the case of unsymmetrical ethers. If the ether is symmetrical, this question will not rise, because X minus can attack any of the R groups and you are going to get same products. But in the case of unsymmetrical ethers, you are going to get different haloalkanes and different types of alcohols. Because of that, you know, this particular discussion is very important in the competitive exams. In order to understand that, you know, where exactly that X minus is attached to R, and that is decided by many factors. One factor is that is what we call it as the nature of the alkyl group attached to the O group, nature of the alkyl group attached to the O group. That is an important factor that will be deciding what we call it as the nature of the products in this particular reaction. In order to explain this, you know, I'll go for three examples. In NCERT book, you know, those three examples will be given there. Yes? And go for one by one. Okay, na? Iga, I'll go for the one example, that is one unsymmetrical ether. That is CH3. That is O, CH2, CH3. This is methoxyethane. This is methoxyethane, yes. So when it reacts with HI, any HX you can go for, yes. Okay, na? Two possibilities, right? One possibility is CH3I plus CH2OH. Another possibility is CH2I plus CH3OH. Notice, in the first case, I minus is attached to CH3. In the second case, I minus is attached to CH3, CH2, right? Two possibilities. Which is possible than the other? Yes. Which is possible? Which reaction is possible in this particular case? Andaga, remember, this is possible in this particular case. Why it is so? I'll explain. Because as far as this chemical reaction is concerned, look at this. The reaction proceeds through the formation of oxonium ion. That is, HI gives H+. HI ni dalaido, this HI dissociates to produce what? H plus and I minus, right? And of course, oxygen atom on the oxygen atom will have lone pair of electrons, and that will attack H plus ion, and you are going to get, yes, it is one of the oxonium ion. That is, you are going to get, this is the oxonium ion. Yes, this is oxonium ion produced, right? Okay, now in the second step, you know, this I minus attacks this oxonium ion. I minus attacks oxonium ion. In the second step, I minus attacks oxonium ion. Yes. Look at this case. Here we have CH3 group and here we have CH3, CH2 group. Both are primary alkyl groups. Both are producing primary carbocations. CH3 produces primary carbocation. C2H5 produces primary carbocation. Both are producing primary carbocations, but this C of the CH3 group is less crowded. C of the CH3 is less crowded, means the C of the CH3 is attached with small alkyl groups like hydrogen atoms. Therefore, I minus can easily attack this, that brings about SN2 reaction. I minus can easily attack CH3, C of the CH3, because The hydrogen atoms are very, very small and much space is available for the nucleophilic attack. Whereas in the case of CH3, CH2, look at this. This is, yes it is. And this is what we call it as CH3, CH2, right? And this I minus and will face some difficulty in attacking this carbon because this carbon is, yes it is, more crowded. How that? Because we have bulky group around the carbon atom. Therefore, this bulky group offers the steric hindrance for the nucleophilic attack. Your nucleophilic attack is very easy because of the small H groups. Therefore, reaction proceeds by SN2 mechanism. Reaction proceeds by SN2 mechanism. If I minus attacks this less crowded carbon, these sigma electrons will be shifted over this. Sigma electrons will be shifted over this and positive charge of the oxygen is neutralized. And you are going to get the product of this type. Yes, it is. You are going to get the product of this type, that is CH3I plus CH3CH2OH. That is CH3CH2OH. So this is what we call it as. This is the product obtained. Agbada? Okay na? Yes. Agagi, on the basis of this, what I can conclude at this moment, when HI reacts with unsymmetrical ethers, when HI reacts with unsymmetrical ether, then iodide nucleophile will be attacking that carbon atom of primary alkyl groups which is least crowded. That carbon atom of primary alkyl group which is least crowded. Atma, if ether is characterized by primary or secondary alkyl groups, if ether is characterized by primary or secondary alkyl groups, then the nucleophile iodide attacks less crowded carbon atom, atma, less crowded alkyl group. So that's why you are going to get CH3I here. You are going to get CH3I here. Hagadre, if the ether contains tertiary alkyl group, if the ether contains tertiary alkyl group, what happens? That is the second case now. If ether contains tertiary alkyl group, what is the product of the reaction? That we'll see, right? Here it is. I'm going to connect. Yes, it is. This is. Yes, it is. This is 2-methoxy-2-methyl, yes it is propane with the tertiary alkyl group, name put it, tertiary alkyl group, and here also two possibilities. If I minus attacks CH3, you are going to get CH3I plus, then H plus will go to O there and you are going to get CH3, and it is OH. This is the possible product. Yes. If I minus attacks tertiary carbon, CH3, and it is CH3, and of course plus CH3OH. Yes, this is the second possibility. Third possibilities. Your in first case I minus is attacking CH3. In the second case, I minus is attacking tertiary butyl group, and these are the two possible reactions. Out of which is more feasible, which is possible in the prashna madre, I go for this. The question rises, why it is so done? The question rises, for that purpose, you know, I am going to explain that particular aspect, okay na? Yes? Yes, we'll see that. As far as, yes it is, this compound ether is concerned, this is the compound, yes, okay na, in presence of H plus silin bantho, H plus is from HI gives off H plus and I minus, right, okay na, lone pair of electrons will absorb H plus and thereby you are going to get oxonium ion, you are going to get oxonium ion, and this is methyl tertiary butyl oxonium ion with positive charge on the oxygen, right? Now, in the second step, look at this. In the second step, this is second step. Here it is primary alcohol group, here it is tertiary alcohol group. Previous case along here, both are primary alcohol groups. Both were producing primary carbocations. This produces primary carbocation, this produces tertiary carbocation. Which will be easily produced? Tertiary carbocation is easily produced because tertiary carbocation is more stable than primary carbocation. Therefore, that will be easily formed. Therefore, the sigma electrons will be moving towards oxygen. Avaga E bond break aagibidutte. E bond break aadre CH3 plus barutte. That is less stable. E bond break aadre tertiary butyl carbocation barutte. That is more stable. And because of that, you are going to get CH3OH plus. Look at this tertiary butyl carbocation. We are going to get tertiary butyl carbocation. Yes. And this tertiary butyl carbocation is attacked by I minus. Tertiary butyl carbocation is attacked by I minus. And that results in the formation of, yes, it is tertiary butyl iodide. That results in the formation of tertiary butyl iodide. Andaga, if the ether contains tertiary alkyl group and primary alkyl group, then I minus will be attached to the tertiary alkyl group because tertiary carbocations are more stable than secondary carbocation, and reaction proceeds through, yes, it is formation of SN, that is carbocation. Therefore, it is SN1 mechanism. It will follow SN1 mechanism because reaction proceeds through the formation of carbocation. So this is the another possibility. Now I'll go for the third example. I'll go for the aromatic, yes, it is ethers. Look at this. This is OR, right? When it reacts with, yes, it is HX. Alright. Which will be where exactly I minus attacks and daga? I minus attacks or OR bond will be broken. And then if OR bond has broken, look at this. Possibilities for it. This is first possibility, and you are going to get this is OH plus and it is R, yes, it is I. Okay, na? So, X and Tagavadhen Tundreva, right? Second possibility, not it. Yes. E bond break, H plus will be attached to O minus, you are going to get phenol, I minus will be attached to R, and you are going to get RI. If this bond is broken, aga, you are going to get plus or OH. These are the two possibilities, right? This benzene to O bond, if this bond is broken, you are going to get this iodine attached to benzene. If OR bond is broken, iodine attached to, yes, it is R. And these are the possibilities. Out of these two, this is possible. This is possible. Yake antandre, look at this. As far as alkoxy benzene is concerned, look at this. In the case of alkoxy benzene, we have two bonds. One it is OR bond, another is O C6H5 bond. Yes, these are the two bonds we have. These are the two bonds we have, OR bond and it is OC6H5 bond. Here, in this case, in the case of OR, carbon atom is sp3 hybridized. In this case, carbon atom is sp2 hybridized. Which is more electronegative? sp2 hybridized carbon atom is more electronegative. Therefore, which bond is strong? OC6H5 bond is strong bond. Yes, OC6H5 bond is strong. At the same time, there is a partial double bond character, is it not? There is a partial double bond character between O and C6H5 due to resonance. This is what we call OR antandre. Electrons will be shifted like this. Again, agate. You are going to get, yes, it is double bond character. Yes, there is a double bond character, partial double bond character between O and C6, carbon atom. One point is, oxygen is attached to sp2 hybridized carbon atom, and there is a double bond character between oxygen and carbon in the case of C6H5O bond. And in this case, therefore, this OCO bond is strong. But here, carbon atom is sp3 hybridized, less electronegative than sp2 hybridized carbon, and here no resonance, single bond is there. Therefore, this bond can be easily broken. And therefore, when this bond has broken, yes, when this bond has broken, you are going to get RI. I minus will be attached to R. And therefore, this is not possible. And because of that, and because of that, you know, yes, when anisole reacts with hydrogen iodide, and this is hydrogen iodide, yes, look at this, this bond will be broken, yes, then you are going to get, yes, it is OH, and a phenol you are going to get plus CH3I. So this is the product there, and of course you can expect this in the examination. You can find this question in some annual examinations, you know, this is methyl iodide, and also in competitive exams you can find the questions on this particular aspect. So this is what we call it as the action of hydrogen iodide on unsymmetrical ethers. Action of hydrogen iodide on unsymmetrical ethers. Arthayitu ankothini. I discussed three cases. Okay. Yeah. Oxybenzene, electrophilic substitution reactions of anisole. I said already, electrophilic substitution reactions are reactions due to the benzene, ring, right? Anisole here, and of course we have anisole with methoxy group attached to the benzene ring with lone pair of electrons on the, yes, it is oxygen, and it is similar to phenol. You know, this is phenol. I already discussed. It is similar to phenol. This is plus R group. OCS3 is also plus R group. You know, I said all plus R groups direct incoming electrophile to attack ortho and para positions, right? At the same time, all plus R groups, they release electrons to the benzene ring because electronic movement is towards benzene ring. Therefore, the electron density of benzene ring increases, thereby reactivity also increases. Therefore, anisole is more reactive towards electrophilic substitution reaction, just like phenol. Yes, it is resonance structures of anisole there. First resonance structure, yes. Because of the shifting of lone pair of electrons like this, you are going to get OCS3. Oxygen lost electrons, therefore it becomes plus there, and it is minus shifting of pi electrons towards this. Okay, now I already said, if I shift the electron pairs over the carbon atom, it will get minus charge. If I shift the electron pairs between the carbon atoms, you are going to get one extra bond. Yes, yes, it is double bond OCH3, and it is plus sigma, and of course sigma it will be minus. It will be shifted like this, right? And then you are going to get, yes, one more resonance structure. Yes, it is. This is double bond at minus OCH3 there. Okay, now plus, this will be shifted like this. This will be shifted like this. And then it is, you are going to get the one more resonance structure of this type. So this is what we call it as the resonance structures of, yes, it is, anisole, where you will find the negative charge on the ortho and para position. This is ortho position with respect to OCS3. This is para and this is ortho. Therefore, OCS3 increases electron density at ortho and para position. Therefore, when anisole undergoes electrophilic substitution reactions like halogenation, alkylation, acylation, and yes, it is nitration, you are going to get ortho and para products. Out of ortho and para products, which is more stable? Para products are more stable than ortho products, and of course because para products are more symmetrical than ortho. At the same time, para products, you know, will offer less steric hindrance among the groups, whereas ortho products will offer more steric hindrance among the groups, and therefore para products are more stable than ortho products. Now let us see chemical properties of anisole, and that, you know, it is halogenation of anisole, yes, and it's quite clear you are going to get ortho and para products, right? When anisole undergoes bromination in presence of acetic acid, right? Substitution at the ortho and para positions. One bromine atom will connect agutte, another bromine atom will connect agutte. Therefore, you are going to get mixture of, yes, it is OCS3, and it is Br ortho and para products. And this is OCS3, and it will be Br plus 2HBr it is. This is the balanced equation. We need 2 benzene ring, therefore multiplied by 2. Yes, we need 4 bromine atoms, therefore multiplied by 2. This is anisole, right? This is 2-bromo anisole. this is 2 bromoanisole, or can say orthobromoanisole. This is 4 bromoanisole and this is 4 bromoanisole, right? Okay, now this is number 1 and this is number 2, number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, 4 bromoanisole. This is what we call it as halogenation. And remember, reaction is carried out in presence of acetic acid. Even we have not used regular reagent, that is ferric bromide. Halogenation and electrophilic substitution reactions of antakshane, we usually go for Lewis acid like ferric bromide. But here, the reactivity of anisole is so high that, you know, even the reaction takes place in the absence of ferric bromide, because of that electron releasing effect of OCS3. Therefore, reaction is carried out in acetic acid medium. That is what we call it as halogenation of anisole, right? Now, at this moment, we'll go for the halogenation, that is Friedel-Crafts alkylation. Friedel-Crafts alkylation of anisole, right? In the Friedel-Crafts reaction, look here. This is OCS3, this is anisole, right? This is H and this is H, and then substitution takes place at these two positions, that is in presence of chloromethane. This is chloromethane, right? Chloromethane, right? And reaction is carried out in presence of anhydrous aluminium chloride. Anhydrous aluminium chloride, that is Lewis acid, a catalyst known as Friedel-Crafts catalyst. And of course, in presence of non-polar medium, the substitution at ortho and para positions takes place. You are going to get ortho-methoxy-toluene. Again, it is named with respect to the toluene. Yes, this is toluene. This parent is considered as a parent. Ortho-methoxy-toluene, that is 2-methoxy-toluene. 2-methoxy-toluene, athwa. Yes, it is ortho-methoxy-toluene. You can call it as ortho-methoxy-toluene. Another is, you can go for, yes, it is OCS3 and it is CH3 here. This is para-methoxy-toluene. And of course, the name is with respect to the toluene as parent. Yes, it is that is para-methoxy-toluene, right? And under the Friedel-Crafts alkylation, it is alkyl group is introduced over the benzene ring, right? In the same manner, we have Friedel-Crafts acylation there. Right? Where you are going to introduce acyl group on the benzene ring. Here we have introduced alkyl group here. Therefore, it is alkylation. I can introduce acyl group like by using acetyl chloride, CsCCOCl, right? This is acetyl chloride, by using acetyl chloride, yes. Same catalyst, anhydrous aluminium chloride, same catalyst, right? And of course, H is replaced by CH3CO. And remember, it is CO, CH3, and it is CO, CH3, right? You are going to get ortho and para products. If OCS3 is not there, it will be acetophenone. If OCS3 is not there, it will be acetophenone. Therefore, it is ortho-methoxy-acetophenone athwa 2-methoxy-acetophenone. 2-methoxy-acetophenone and of course 4-methoxy-acetophenone. 4-methoxy-acetophenone athwa para-methoxy-acetophenone. Yes. Out of these two, para product is more stable than ortho product. Yes. So this is what we call it as one more chemical reaction as far as electrophilic substitution reactions of anisole is concerned. That is acylation, Friedel-Crafts acylation, where we have introduced acyl group because your CH3CO plus is the electrophile. Hagagi, you have to connect carbon of CO to the benzene ring. Kelo students think what better yada kertu di nimige. This is CH3CO anta barbartaringa. Now, that is CO has to be connected to, C of CO has to be connected to, yes, it is benzene ring, right? Now, last reaction of this particular discussion, that is, yes, it is nitration of anisole, right? Nitration of anisole. That is nitration of anisole, right? Go for it. Yes, you know, nitration is carried out in presence of mixture of concentrated sulfuric acid and concentrated nitric acid. And of course, we already studied that in phenol cases. So just remember, phenol also, while writing these reactions, there also you have got ortho and paraprophenol, carprophenol, yes. And of course, when anisole reacts with mixture of concentrated nitric acid and concentrated sulfuric acid, known as nitrating mixture. HNO3 and OHNO12 parithini. And of course, reaction takes place, and of course, upon heating, and you are going to get, yes, it is 2 nitroanisole and 4 nitroanisole. Yes, you are going to get 2 nitroanisole and 4 nitroanisole plus 2H2O. Yes, it is 2 molecules you need. Yes, this is 2 nitroanisole. Athwa ortho nitroanisole, yes, and this is 4 nitroanisole, athwa paranitroanisole, right, and of course, this is what we call it as nitration of anisole, right. So, that is what we call it as electrophilic substitution reactions. And then, if any molecule contains benzene ring, definitely that undergoes electrophilic substitution reactions, and substitution takes place over the benzene ring. So, this is anisole. Its properties are almost similar to that of phenol with respect to electrophilic substitution reactions. So with that, we'll go for the, yes, it is. That completes the discussion, alcohols, phenols and ethers. So through these 10 videos, I tried my level best to convince you people the concepts of the chapter alcohols, phenols and ethers. Okay, na? Thank you very much. Thanks for the cooperation, right? So, in the under the description, I'm giving one link. Use that link in order to download notes on that particular chapter, that is alcohols, phenols and ethers. Agboda, thank you very much, right?